Hello, I'm Locke Meredith. I'd like to invite you to join me on today's Legal Lines. We're very pleased to have on the show Jay Darden. Jay is a Louisiana state senator. He's been in the Senate for 13 years. He was basically the number two man in power when Governor Foster was in office. He's talking about the change in the leadership and the effect that has, and basically how the legislature works through the committee system. So join us on the next Legal Lines with Jay Darden. Welcome to Legal Lines. I'm Locke Meredith. I'm very pleased to have on the show Jay Darden. He's a Louisiana state senator. Been there for how long?
13 years.
Jay, thank you so much for being back on the show.
Nice to be here. Good to see you.
Let's talk about quick personal information for folks who don't know anything about you, and then talk about what's going on.
Well, I practice law in the real world, and I've been in the Senate now for 13 years. It's hard to believe I'm beginning my last term. We have term limits, so this will be the last term I can serve consecutively. I started out kind of throwing some stones, and during that last Edwards term, being against a lot of things that were going on during the Edwards regime, and
kind of on the outs.
On the outs. In the past 8 years, I've been on the ends. I was supportive of Governor Foster and was chairman of the Senate Finance Committee, and handled really all the major pieces of legislation that.
You were a major player with Governor Foster.
Well, I was very involved in a lot of things, and in the worm turns politically, and that's not the case right now.
Let's talk about that, because it's got to be really interesting to have been in the position of power and influence that you were. Not that you used it in a bad way or anything, but let's face it, you held a significant position of power and influence and had access to the governor and the leadership pretty much any time, I would expect, and now you don't. Explain that to me.
Well, it's a part of the political process. A governor comes in, particularly in Louisiana, and basically designates who they want to be their legislative leaders, and the governor has a lot to do with
most
who
powerful
the legislative
governor in the United States.
I think based upon constitution, laws, and most importantly practice and tradition, that is in fact the case. And so the governor pretty much decides who he or she wants to be in legislative positions of leadership, and the president of the Senate, the Speaker of the House, appoints committee chairmen. And usually appoints people that they are close to and that find favor with the governor. And in this new administration, I have been one that was not so chosen. So it's a different role for me. It changes my workload. It changes the degree of responsibility I have. But it doesn't change my fervor for the job and my desire to make sure that we still keep Louisiana pointed in the right direction.
And you were chairman of the Finance Committee and multiple other committees. You were on them, right?
Correct.
And as the chairman, I guess you regulate the flow or the presentation of the various bills and the information and opposition and all of that.
That's right. You decide when bills are scheduled for hearing, and you have a lot to do with the success or failure of the bills. And most importantly, from the Finance Committee standpoint, you handle the budget. So that is the committee that decides how to, recommends to the full body how to spend $16, $17 billion each year.
Boy, that's amazing. And now you're just a member on the committees. I mean, are you still on the committees you were on previously?
I'm on three of the four committees I was on. I'm on Education and Senate and Governmental Affairs, which deals with ethics laws. I'm on the Judiciary B Committee, which handles gambling matters. I am a member of the Budget Committee when we're not in session, but I'm not a member of the Finance Committee, which is the committee that handles the money.
And the reason you are not on the Finance Committee is, I guess, just different political views?
Because the President of the Senate chose not to appoint me to that committee.
Okay.
So that's just the political vagaries that take place.
And so how do they decide? I mean, is politics strictly the criteria used to decide what committee you're going to be appointed to?
Pretty much. I mean, there's certainly some deference given to experience or areas of particular expertise or interest, but frankly it's mostly driven by politics and by who the President of the Senate wants on a particular committee and how they want to stack a committee one particular way or the other based upon a philosophy or a region or whether you're viewed as being favorable to the leadership or not.
And the reason that the committee is so important is why? I mean, as I appreciate it, the committee is where the bill is generated, or we think there needs to be a law to address this situation, and y'all put it together, and then y'all make a recommendation, or someone submits a bill, and y'all make a recommendation. That recommendation to the legislative body carries great weight.
Well, that's right. And the committee is basically the clearinghouse for all legislation. You've got to get through a committee before you go to the Senate. So, for example, I'll give you a particular example, a minimum wage bill that's being debated right now.
Going from, what, 515 to 615?
Right. That's a bill which I think is a bad idea. We can come back and talk about
right.
that. But in any event, that bill is assigned to a committee based upon its substantive composition. For example, that bill goes to the Labor Committee because it deals with wages.
Okay.
On every Senate standing committee are seven people. Seven out of 39 senators serve on a committee, except the big committees like Finance had 11 members. Anyway, there's seven members who serve on that Labor Committee, four of whom would constitute a win. If you get 4-3, you're going to get the bill referred to the full Senate. But committees are even more important than that because you can have a quorum of four people, and one of those people can be a non-voting member, and a bill can get to the full floor of the Senate with a 2-1 vote, which is what happened on that bill. That's why I use it as an example. Only two people in the legislature wanted that bill to advance to the Senate for a hearing, but it is advancing for a hearing because the committee voted it out, 2-1.
Interesting.
So that's why it's important who's on the committees and what the makeup of the committee is, but generally, in a close situation or a controversial situation, you may have a 4-3 vote, you may have a 3-2 vote, depending upon who's there in the committee. But if the bill can't get out of committee, it does not ever come to the full floor for debate.
The door's closed.
That's right.
All right. And so once the bill, I guess the legislator says, I have this issue, this is my legislation to address it, this is my what I want to be the law, the committee folks view it, tweak it. Do y'all change the language on it?
Absolutely. Amend it. That's very much a part of the process.
Okay. And based on your, I guess, your philosophy, your political philosophy, depends on what tweaking is going to take place.
Right.
And then it's voted out. And then what happens?
Goes to the full floor of the Senate for debate, where it can be amended again, changed in that process. If the bill passes the Senate, has to have 20 votes out of 39, a majority, it then goes to the House of Representatives and starts the same process all over. If it's a House bill, it originates in the House and goes through that committee process, then to the floor of the House, then to the Senate committee, then to the Senate floor. Has to go through all four of those processes, and if there is a disagreement between the two chambers on what the language ought to be.
But if it's passed by the Senate and passed by the House, but it's different language or different issues.
Goes to a conference committee.
Which is what?
Which is a very interesting and seldom understood part of the process, but the pivotal part, because
I imagine that happens all the time.
It happens fairly regularly. Conference committee, you have three senators and three representatives. The Senate president appoints the three conferees on the Senate side, the speaker on the House side. It's usually the author of the bill, the chairman of the committee that heard the bill, and one other person who is not necessarily in favor of the bill. So you have six people.
Get a little voice of opposition.
That's right.
Okay.
You have six people, and they get together and decide on what the language ought to be, and then it goes back to the two houses for one up or down vote. You either like it like they've finally amended it, or you don't, and that's what decides whether or not a bill becomes law.
Statistically, if it goes through that process, does the legislative body vote up or down?
Usually up. More often than not, I wouldn't have the specifics, but out of, let's just say there are 1,000 legislative instruments that get through that process, it's probably 15% or 20% that go to conference at most.
Okay.
And of those 15 or 20%, I'm just guessing on those numbers, probably 3/4 of them actually become law.
Okay. And at the, or in the legislative body, there's actually debates where you guys get up and you voice
sure.
your complaints or your support. Is that really influence anybody?
Absolutely. Unlike as we know as in lawyers, sometimes you feel
sometimes
like when
those judges don't listen
when
to
when you make an oral argument, you're not sure if it's doing any good or
That's
not.
Right.
But in the halls of the legislature, it's very persuasive because you have to rely upon information that you get during the process to help you shape your decision. But very often, if someone gets up and makes a lot of good points, makes an impassioned plea on behalf of a particular piece of legislation, that can be very persuasive in people's spontaneous decision on what they're going to do.
All right, I want to talk about the processing of information on the next segment. This is Locke Meredith with Legal Lines and Jay Darden, and we'll be right back. Welcome back to Legal Lines. I'm Locke Meredith, and I have Louisiana State Senator Jay Darden on the show again. Jay, thank you for being
on
the show.
Thank you, Locke. My pleasure.
We were talking about kind of the committee process and basically how a bill will work its way through the legislative process. And we were talking during the break there, how much deference do you give as a legislator to the committee recommendation? Because what you've just described to me is a very political process.
Well, on bills that are generally non-controversial, you give a lot of deference to the committee's work, recognizing that they're going to try and ferret out what's appropriate and what's not. You tend to know what's politically charged. You hear from constituents, you hear from lobbyists, you already have a predisposition about a particular issue, and that helps you decide what your position is going to be on the floor. Simply because a bill passes a committee doesn't mean automatically that it's going to get my support or a particular legislator's support.
Interesting. What are the big issues? What would you divide up kind of the nuts and bolts issues that's facing the legislature right now, and then we'll talk about the political issues?
Well, all of them are political issues. There are some that get a lot of media attention that are not necessarily, in my view, critically important issues to the welfare of the people of the state, but they get high profile anyway. And then there are those issues that are important for education, for health, for economic development, things that are at the core of what we ought to be about in terms of making policy and making laws for the people of the state.
How do you get your information, and how do you analyze it, and who helps you analyze it, and what is the influence of Blow Joe on the street sending you an email or calling on the phone?
Well, that's a bunch of
questions. It's a lot of questions, I know. It's basically processing of information.
Well, but it's important, though, because 144 legislators are by no means experts on all the matters that we're called upon to decide. And I don't know everything I need to know about all issues that I have to make very critical votes on that are going to affect people in this state. So, first of all, I try and educate myself as best I can. I read a lot. I read the bills. I try and understand issues on my own. I rely upon lobbyists, and lobbyists in and of themselves are not bad people, and that's not a bad word. I mean, I need that information, and I need to hear people's viewpoints.
You understand that they may be slanted depending on who's sending them to you, lobby versus the trial lawyers.
Took the words out of my mouth. I've got to filter that information. I'm going to get it from a lobbyist, but I know that that lobbyist has a viewpoint, that he or she's being paid to represent a particular viewpoint, or maybe they're not being paid, but they have a particular bias toward an issue. And I have to listen, and I have to filter that and decide what I think is right and what is not right. Very seldom, if ever, do you get misled by people who are trying to persuade you.
It's almost like a judge.
Sitting
as a judge, and each side presents their viewpoint of the evidence.
People know that it's not going to serve their ultimate purpose to try and mislead you or try and tell you something that's not true.
Because if you find out they've lied to you, you're never going to trust them.
That's right. They have no credibility at all, and credibility is very important in this process. And then I rely upon what I've read, what I've been told, and what I hear from my constituents. I have one staff person, Kathy Berry, who is my legislative assistant. She gets 300 emails a day. She gets dozens of phone calls a day.
We couldn't survive without her.
Of pieces of mail. That's right. and it's a staff of one. Though we have a good and an extensive staff at the Senate to deal with substantive issues, they're not available to make political decisions or provide assistance on the politics, if you will, of what's driving an issue. But I listen to what I hear from my constituents. They are very informed. They are very vocal. And we get blanket emails, blast emails, if you will.
What is that?
It's where you just send out the same message to everybody, and the same people are sending you the same message over
and
over.
How much does that influence? Because I know, trial lawyers will send me, say there's an issue on the floor, communicate with your representatives, and I'll respond occasionally. How much does that influence you?
Well, it influences me from the standpoint that I know that message is out there from a particular group, and I know that they've been able to touch a number of people to deliver that message. What touches me more, though, are phone calls or personal letters from people advising me of their position. I'm not able to check the weather vane on every issue, though, and go solely with who's doing the best job of communicating an issue. I feel like I've been elected by the people to evaluate issues and to make decisions that I think are best for my constituents. And though everybody is not going to agree with my decision all of the time, I would hope that people would say, well, that's somebody who listens, that's somebody who tries to make a reasoned and a learned decision, and that's about the best you can do.
How do you communicate with your constituents? How many folks do you have in your district?
Over 100,000, 125,000
people. How in the world do you communicate effectively with 100,000 folks?
Well, it depends upon those who are trying to communicate with me.
We hear so few people vote. 100,000 folks, how many people really communicate with you?
I don't know how to gauge the percentage other than to tell you that we get literally multiple hundreds of emails a day while we're in session, dozens and dozens of phone calls. The phone rings all during the day with people wanting to ask questions or provide information.
I'm glad to hear that.
And you try and respond as best you can within reason. And I'm very accessible, I think, relatively speaking. I think most legislators are, in terms of responding to phone calls, being out in the community, trying to field people's questions and listen to what they have to say.
What influences you the most, lobbyists or your constituents?
It's not an either-or. They're all providing information. I try to be respectful of what I believe to be the majority viewpoint in my district, and I usually believe that I should vote to reflect their viewpoint. But I also feel very strongly that I've been elected to make tough decisions and to not necessarily go simply with where I think people want me to go, that I have to try and make a decision based upon the best interest of my constituents, the best interest of the state as a whole. And that's a constant balancing act of trying to figure out what's the right thing to do.
How do you decide what the majority view is? I mean, do y'all literally keep track of how many pros and cons?
Sometimes we do, just as a matter of interest, if it's a hot issue that we know there's a lot of information on both sides. But I don't keep score and say, okay, 25 here and 22 here, I'm going with the 25s.
Right.
But I balance what the viewpoints are. And most importantly, I try and help make an educated decision based upon my knowledge of the issue.
Yeah, that's what you're there for.
That's right.
Because you're more educated, frankly, than everybody else once you've accumulated this information and processed.
Well, I certainly have more information, I guess, than most people do, because I'm the one who gets to push that red button or green button, and people are trying to make sure that I know what I'm doing when I make that decision.
What are the big issues right now that you're facing?
The budget is always the biggest issue of all. How we're going to spend almost $17 billion of the people's money to move our state forward from an economic development standpoint, in education, and in health care. That's always an overriding fundamental issue that supersedes everything and that usually is connected to almost every other issue
that's
debated.
It boils down to the buck. And Stelly, I assume, is generating more money, isn't it?
I
know I'm paying a whole lot more in taxes.
You know, it's interesting. It is generating some more money, but not that much. It's kind of right on target with what the economists suggested. And your income bracket is such that you're one of the ones who's paying more. A lot of people are paying less. And
is it really a lot? Because I had fellow Mr. Kane, and you know, he was pretty opposed to it, and his analysis is that really more people are paying taxes than I think everybody thought initially.
Well, I don't think the data bears out a lot of what James David is saying in terms of the impact of the plan, and we're going to have to see. That's one of the things we're going to do in this next year, is see the hard numbers of what income went up and how many taxpayers paid more. The revenue department told me this week that there have been more people getting refunds than more people paying taxes, which was an interesting commentary in the wake of what people expected from the bill. Health care is always going to be a big issue. What we do with the charity hospital system, and in particular what we do with Earl K. Long in this community, is a yet to be decided fundamental issue going forward.
I'll tell you what, let's address this on the next segment. Slock Meredith with Legal Lines and Jay Darden. We'll be right back.